My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do I really know myself. And the fact that I think that I am following your will does not mean that I'm actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you. And I hope that I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore will I trust you always, though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death. I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone.
Good evening. We thank you for joining us again for the seventh program in our series, A Hermit's Journal, The 3-Month Trial, broadcast on Doves for Peace channel at 8 p.m. Greenwich Mean Time, and today at 4 p.m. Eastern Daylight Savings Time in the USA. We welcome you to join us in the weeks to come as we go through what happens and what follows from this trial. But if it does not fit your schedule to be there at those times, you can find our videos on YouTube, where our friend David Holmes posts them on his YouTube site. Just type in A Hermit's Journal and you will find all the programs leading up to this one.
Since mid-January, we've been looking back and reflecting on Karen's experience of first testing out her call to eremitic life by living for 3 months in a very simple dwelling on church property in the village of Anstead, West Virginia. Karen has graciously opened her personal journal entries to us, which allow us to experience this initiation of hers into hermit life just as it actually unfolded in the winter and the early spring of 1989. When we concluded our reflection last week, we had been spending quite a bit of our focus on the experience Karen was having of a sort of depression and being faced with personal realizations that she found uncomfortable and troubling. And I wanted to preface our remarks this evening by stating that oftentimes we read about the ancient desert fathers and mothers. We talk about classic eremitic life, and we read accounts of hermits who struggle with demons, and it's often pictured in a very exotic, sometimes bizarre and even macabre way. But we have to remember that the greatest struggles that come about from going out into the desert are the struggles with the inner demons. That the loneliness, the depressions, the temptations that we experience, it's the struggle with the inner demons, parts of our own personality, the shadow self, the false self, the various projects of the ego. And not surprisingly, for Karen, as we reflected last week, many of the issues that were surfacing were the issues that went to the very core of religious living. For any Christian called to the religious life has to address the evangelical councils, whether they be part of a monastic tradition, part of a just ordinary ministry in the church, or simply the response of any individual to the gospel of Jesus Christ needs to factor in the call of chastity, of poverty, and of obedience. And whenever we grapple with and wrestle with the issues of connectivity, relatedness, and relationships that are meaningful for us and intimate for us in our world, we're dealing with chastity, with what it means to love chastely, married, unmarried, vowed, religious. That's of much less importance. And whenever we wrestle with and look at the issues of security and insecurity in our life, we're dealing with evangelical poverty. That's the issue we're really dealing with. In whom is my trust? Where do my anxieties arise? And by the same measure, whenever we look at issues of control in our life, power, we're talking about the council of obedience. And whether or not we belong to an institution, we live out our Christian commitment in a community, an institution, formal institution, or whether we're simply living out our own individual careers and vocations and marriage relationships, or whether we're single or we have some other kind of committed relationship, we can't take the gospel of Jesus Christ seriously without dealing with these particular issues. And for many of us, these are the big demons that we're going to wrestle with in our interior life, whether we live that out with others or in solitude.
Yes. As Paul said, the last time we talked, things weren't just coming up roses for me. And he asked me, he says, did you expect some of these fears that troubled you in these strange situations? And the truth was that it was yes and no. Theoretically, I knew that there would be problems, that there would be questions, there would be struggles, tough times. But on the other hand, I really didn't know what exactly these would be until they hit me. And I was using the lectionaries and reading the prayer, the scriptures for the days during Lent. And it was when I was reading, I was drawn to the imagery of the Israelites entering the promised land after 40 years of wandering in the desert. And it was so clear that 30 years in the monastery, now moving into hermit life. Paul, I want to just kind of refresh that story from the Old Testament, that event from Deuteronomy.
Right. This particular section comes in chapter 11, and it's part of a very long speech that is put in the mouth of the prophet Moses. And he's been delineating the law and the precepts and the new covenant that that the people of Israel have entered into with God. And at this point, Moses says this in chapter 11. He says, "Therefore, take these words of mine into your heart and soul, bind them at your wrist as a sign, and let them be a pendant on your forehead. Teach them to your children, speaking of them at home and abroad, whether you are busy or at rest, and write them on the doorposts of your houses and on your gates, so that as long as the heavens are above the earth, you and your children may live on the land in which the Lord swore to your fathers he would give them. For if you are careful to observe all these commandments I enjoin on you, loving the Lord your God and following his ways exactly and holding fast to him, the Lord will drive all these nations out of your way, and you will dispossess nations greater and mightier than yourselves. Every place where you set foot shall be yours, from the desert and from Lebanon, from the Euphrates River to the Western Sea shall be your territory. None shall stand up against you. The Lord your God will spread the fear and dread of you through any land where you set foot, as he promised you. I set before you here this day a blessing and a curse. A blessing for obeying the commandments of the Lord your God, which I enjoin on you today, and a curse if you do not obey the commandments of the Lord your God, but turn aside from the way that I ordained for you today to follow other gods whom you have not known." Karen?
Yes, that's very strong, blunt language. But the way it struck me, it was March 1st, a Wednesday, and I wrote this after my morning prayer. "How delicately you teach love to me. It is today clear and sunny, frost fresh, and the birds alert and calling. The first day of March, a new month, which will usher spring in, but is yet gripped by winter. It is mid-Lent precisely, a day of celebration in the monastery. I sit here trying to pull my spirit back from concern how I shall manage things after Easter. I'm already trying to figure out how to pack and clean up, etc. But no, this isn't the time for that. I have 4 weeks yet, and I know I'm only beginning to get a sense of the freedom and the love, which is part of the mystery of solitude, of how to live without fear that something could take me from you or come between us. Learning how to live in true liberty of spirit with unguarded heart and senses, totally open to all that now is. This is the statutes and decrees that you want me to observe as I enter this strange new land you are calling me to, so I can take possession and live free and whole, healed and joy-filled, to become that secret source of joy for others. I failed to be that for many of my friends, and it has wakened me to the unreality that I was falling prey to. Teach me love and free me, for you alone can do it. Merton called March this gay, windy month, and so it is. It is also a time when I can feel most deeply the pain of my emptiness, of that terrible hunger and thirst for one who, like the dancing bright sunlight, is, yes, already here, but when I go to clasp him, my arms only embrace the cold, laughing wind, and I end hugging my pain, wobbling drunkenly down the brown, pathless hills. March is the time of the here but not yet, the truth of salvation. It's stark, no leaves or even buds, only last year's brown scuttling leaves over the muddy ground. But somehow you know it's there. Maybe it's the angle of the light, that peculiarly penetrating brightness that seems to expose the raw nerve of emptiness. These are the hard days. No let's pretend is possible. And to run is useless. There is no end to this brown, bare land. It'll turn green in its own time. But now is not that time. No wonder the wind moans so quietly. What good would it do to howl? Today, taunted by questions about my being a hermit, today's scriptures about obeying the law so one can possess the new land that one is promised. I won't know my own deepest law unless I go into this new land of solitude. Not to go, then, means never knowing, and risk never fulfilling the purpose for which I, Karen, was created. Love is at the heart of all this. How does one love in solitude?
How indeed? How indeed? As rich as some of the earlier images were that came to you in your prayer and in your dream in the early part of your experience, they were gravitated around pregnancy and giving birth and new life, and those were rich and poignant images. And these are every bit as rich, because now the image is more of your own personal exodus story, your own journey into the promised land, seeing eremitic life as the promise that God is holding out for you. And now the appetite for that has been whetted, and there's still a ways to go. It's, in one sense, it's here, but like you say, in March, it's here, but not yet. March is such a difficult month to navigate. It's one which a popular storyteller and raconteur here in the United States, Garrison Keillor, likes to mention that God gave us March so that people who don't imbibe of alcohol would know what a hangover feels like. March can be that way. It can be a very difficult time. And it more or less coincides in your journey right now with this risk-taking and this wanting to remain true to the vision, but still with anxieties, still with this feeling of lack of resolution about many things. But you, for you, it seems that your experience of nature, your experience of your surroundings, whatever they are, so often mirror and are connected with what's going on inside of you, in your inner life. Did you feel this happening at this point?
Oh, I did. There was something which felt rather amazing to me took place around this time. You may recall that I've made reference to seeing a tall trestle bridge which crossed the deep gorge where the Mill Creek was running very deep at that point. And as I looked at it, I realized that it was an abandoned railroad bridge. And I wrote, I found out how to get to the trestle bridge. At first, I didn't know how to reach it. And then I found a path and I could cross over that bridge. I could see there was a beautiful path along the other bank of Mill Creek. I'm not sure that I'd like to cross that trestle bridge by myself. The bridge is probably safe for foot travel, but it had a few rotted boards
points
on it,
yeah,
and there were no railings, and it was very high. So I was feeling a deal of anxiety about crossing that bridge.
Still, you felt like you...
I was being drawn to it.
Okay.
I remember I would walk down to the beginning of the bridge, and I would look across day after day, knowing that I'm not really great on heights, but I do have to share this with you. It was the evening of the 3rd of March, and I wrote, "It was mostly sunny and warmer today. My spirit is responding to the springier weather. And I did something wonderful and daring. I followed the track to the trestle bridge. And as I studied it, I realized it was very wide and sturdy looking. So I walked across to find a marvelous path, the remnant of the old railroad bed, I think, between the cliff walls covered with icicles and the steep slope down to Mill Creek. The numerous trees and pines and rhododendrons make it a much more private and secluded place to walk than I found anywhere else here, especially since the fishermen have invaded. One of the nicest features is there's almost no trash over here. I saw two Pepsi cans and a new candy wrapper. There were footprints in a snow-covered patch, which indicated that a couple men, probably fishermen, had probably walked through earlier today. But I love the privacy of this walk. But I also feel just a bit vulnerable in such a setting. Much as I first did walking the road along Mill Creek, I'm not going to let fear stop me from exploring this lovely path. There, at least, I find the seclusion that I associate with being a hermit. If I'm back here in warm weather, it'll be a grand place to spend part of a day. The lack of trash clearly attests at how little it is used. My first thoughts included what a romantic place to wander. I felt a little afraid that I'd get dizzy on the way over crossing the trestle bridge, but I did it. And it wasn't too bad. I think I knew when I left the house what I was going to do, but hadn't consciously admitted it. I said I was just going to see where the access to the trestle bridge could be found.
Well, you may not have consciously known how you would actually proceed, but it just seems that your newfound courage kind of to actually cross that bridge and get into an area, go over the bridge into an area that really, the way you describe it, you could have been describing your own personal promised land. You even characterize the sense of privacy and enclosure there as much more resembling or imaging the seclusion that you associated with hermit life.
Yes.
And for you, I think this represents, this crossing over represents an inner kind of crossing over. You've been doing a lot of work with this becoming free and following this call into eremitic life. And even though you had a lot of anxieties about the surface things, about like where would I live and how would I do this after the 3 months, right now it's more your own personal courage of taking the risk. And I think even though it might not have been a real dangerous thing externally, I think it represented for you an internal risk of really crossing over, actually not just standing at the entrance of eremitic life and looking for where one might access it, but actually getting on that bridge and crossing over, as the Israelites, like you said, you'd been meditating on that, as the Israelites crossed over into the promised land.
Yeah, I think you've captured it exactly. I'm not even sure that at the time I was putting that all together.
Well, at the time that these experiences happen to us, we really don't put it all together. It takes time, and sometimes it takes years to really clarify in our own minds and hearts what the Lord is calling us to and what the Lord is doing, how he's shaping our life and how he's bringing us fully alive. And that takes time. When we're in the midst of the experience, oftentimes those subtleties escape us. You were, during this time, I remember a couple presentations ago, you were talking about ordinarily that you had some contact with Father Weber and with Sister Gert. Did you have contact with anybody else during this time?
There were occasional visitors, but it was very rare. But I got a call from Sister Gert. And she said that secular Franciscan woman who lived up in Spencer, West Virginia, had contacted her. She somehow had heard that this poor Claire was living in Anstead, and she wanted to get in contact with me. Well, this was the first that I'd ever heard of Sister Jean,
And so she did contact you?
She did. It was on the Saturday evening, the 4th of March. And just as I started fixing lunch, Jeannie called. Just she and her companion, sister, will come to visit me next Friday. In fact, they've already offered me a hermitage at their place, which might evade the bishop problem because it wasn't church property. Just to have such possibilities turn up almost unsought helps to confirm that I am to stay on in hermit life. Their place is very primitive, I know, but I definitely want to see it. Who knows? Maybe I could survive roughing it now. I'm getting stronger as the months go by. Their place is way out in the woods, which is a strong plus for me. Also, Spencer is a couple hours closer to Canton. And while my daddy's still alive, he was living in a nursing home, and I was his guardian. I felt that I was on a leash that could only stretch so far. I needed to stay close enough to look after my daddy. And that day I wrote about another discovery. My love, what a lovely, deeply satisfying, scenic place I've discovered. After crossing the trestle, I went the opposite direction from yesterday, and I ended up at the base of the bridge, where I could see two waterfalls at once without even turning my head. One was a step cascade from a feeder stream, one that I eventually called the Bridal Veil Falls. The other part was of Mill Creek itself falling over a cliff. I sat on a boulder for a while until my bottom got too cold. Then I found a perfect perch on the root of a huge old pine. Directly across the creek stands the remains of an old stone block building, somewhat mossy, adding a romantic touch of mystery to the whole scene. I was grabbed and held in such deep stillness. Was it joy that was so painful? To be all alone there amid the mossy stones and the shady green trees, with the sounds of rushing waters and the play of sunlight warm on my back and shimmering over the water. There was the smooth, still green pool and the white frothing torrent, all in this one exquisite place. I said, I can put up my tent here and abide forever in this place, doing nothing but watching the seasons dress and change the scene. Oh my God, I sat there for a long time. I'll go back often in the next few weeks, especially if it gets warmer. If it's so lovely now, before any sign of spring is evident, what will it be like in the green seasons?
Karen, thanks so much for sharing that experience of just the that awesome place that drew you in so completely. It certainly embodies, I mean, it's apparent that it embodies for you that promised land, that land of promise, that the Lord is holding out to you in eremitic life. It's Laetare Sunday you're coming up on.
Mm-hmm.
The Lenten readings have been speaking very loudly to you. How did you want to describe for us some of what did you find the readings for Laetare Sunday equally moving?
Oh, they were profoundly helpful. I was the first one was from Joshua. There was a quote from the readings from Paul that came in. And then there was a beautiful gospel story. But Paul, first I would like you to share the read from Joshua chapter 5. That particularly meant a lot to me.
Yeah. This comes in chapter 5 of the book of Joshua, and it's when the Israelites, it's part of the account of when the Israelites first entered into the land of Canaan. Then the Lord said to Joshua, "Today I have removed the reproach of Egypt from you. Therefore, the place is called Gilgal to the present day." While the Israelites were encamped at Gilgal on the plains of Jericho, they celebrated the Passover on the evening of the 14th of the month. On the day after the Passover, they ate of the produce of the land in the form of unleavened cakes and parched grain. On that same day, after the Passover on which they ate of the produce of the land, the manna ceased. No longer was there manna for the Israelites, who that year ate of the yield of the land of Canaan.
And that reading so spoke to me. This is what I wrote after my morning prayer on Laetare Sunday. Such rich, rich readings, which speak to me as never before. Today, I have removed the reproach of Egypt from you, the reproach of your exile. Today, I have ended your slavery to the inner tyrant. And this is what I'm hearing said to me. And to selfishness, to need for security. And I set you free in this good and spacious land to eat of its bounty. You no longer need the manna, which is thin and tasteless, but can now be fully alive, enjoying the broad play and the riches of your whole body and inner feelings and outer senses. And a quote from Paul, "If anyone is in Christ, that one is a new creation. So it is, love. You are remaking me. For the first time, I feel the spontaneous insight and joy to celebrate as the return of the prodigal son." Must have felt. I have been that prodigal, wasteful daughter. But when I come back ashamed to my father, he robes me in the finest gown, restores my dignity, puts shoes on my feet so I can walk freely, and gives me his own ring as a sign and proof of his faithful love. I know I am also that elder son who never had the courage to risk loving and giving, but now can begin to learn how to celebrate and rejoice with real feeling and prodigal abandon.
Gradually, it really sounds, those entry, that entry really kind of points to the fact that your anxieties and the difficulties and the kind of the loose ends that you were feeling earlier are gradually being replaced by a real confidence, a trust, and a joy, and even not just joy, even a level of exhilaration at the new life that you're feeling. You know, you actually sense God remaking you, you know, and putting you, not only remaking you, but situating you in an entirely new environment where you can thrive, not just survive, but really thrive. I mean, we hear that coming through in what you're saying. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you want to continue with what else happened that particular day?
That was a Sunday. And the liturgy was celebrated in the late afternoon. In the evening, I wrote this. It's still heavily overcast, but the heavy rains have stopped, here at least, and it's relatively warm. After all the peopling, and that was with meeting with people at Mass and some people who had dropped in on me earlier, I'm trying to find my way down again to my center. But I know I'm not as dislocated as I would have been a month ago. A woman named Doreen had stopped in the afternoon. And I wrote, Doreen's visit was a pleasure. But then I found myself suddenly listening to her darkest secret and hearing so much pain and loneliness behind the simple words. She's held herself together and become a more whole person with no help from anyone. I admire her as much as I feel compassion for her. Then, after Mass, I was hearing more stories of the hard struggles of these dear people. I can feel your love reaching out to them through me with so much care and tenderness that it is painful to bear it. For I feel so helpless to give it expression. There was a time, not so very long ago, when I wouldn't have been in touch with this pain or able to name it. All my life, I've shielded myself from really feeling my emotions. I feared the pain of it too much. Now, only now, as I dare to become more open and vulnerable to your love, am I coming into my own ability to love. I also found a letter in the sacristy from Father Kieran, my spiritual guide at that time, and with a timely and profound advice. He wrote to me, "Your solitary venture, I know, continues to be a blessing. Where it will lead, only God knows. Trust him, her, just for today. Open yourself to God's hug right now." Hildegard says, "You are encircled by the arms of the mystery of God. That's enough. Continue to delight in the compassion of God, who brings you to new life as you die to yourself." He wrote that to me, and I marveled. He said, "How does he know this is where I am at?" And I was also taken by the quote on the cover of the card that he had chosen. It read, "Like billowing clouds, like the incessant gurgles of the brooks, the longing of the soul can never be stilled. That too was a quote from Hildegard. How deeply I appreciate this imagery, especially after my weeks here at Mill Creek. Let spring begin while I'm still here, love, that I may see the first wild flowers and the budding leaves. It's a real grief to think that I might miss it all. Oh, love, I just can't. Do something, please.
And?
And?
Did the Lord do something?
Yes, but I got an answer to my plea through Scripture again.
Really? Okay.
Always. And the incident in the Scripture was taken from a passage in the Gospels, John 4, 46 to 53. And I wish you would just refresh people's minds on that, because I don't believe we all know just exactly where our scriptures are.
Well, this comes at the very end of chapter 4 in the Gospel of John, and it describes an event that happened when Jesus returned to Cana, where he had changed water into wine at that famous wedding. He had traveled back up from Judea back to Cana. And John says that nearby at Capernaum, there happened to be a royal official whose son was ill. And when he heard that Jesus had come back from Judea to Galilee, he went to him and begged him to come down and restore health to his son, who was near death. Jesus replied, "Unless you people see signs and wonders, you do not believe." "Sir," the royal official pleaded with him, "come down before my child dies." Jesus told him, "Return home. Your son will live." The man put his trust in the word that Jesus spoke to him, and he started back for home. He was on his way there when his servants met him with the news that his boy was going to live. And when he asked them at what time the boy had shown improvement, they told him the fever left him yesterday afternoon about 1. It was at that very hour the father realized that Jesus had told him, "Your son is going to live." And so the man and his whole household thereupon became believers.
That was spoke to me again. But I was pondering early in the morning. I had spent time meditating on it. And I mentioned that I was kept waking up all night thinking it was near morning. There were very heavy rains at time, and I could hear that even the little stream in the ravine was as loud as Mill Creek, and I realized there must be lots of flooding. I had a strange feeling dream, a major theme of moving out of the house in Kent. Remember, all dreams that took place in the house where I grew up were important dreams. And in the process, I saw new sides of my parents, of my sister Gail, and others. I experienced nostalgia and sadness. I think all of this indicates the great move taking place within me. A definitive change is going on. Quoting the scriptures, "Lo, I am about to create a new heavens and a new earth, no remembrance of past sad times, but instead always rejoicing and happiness in what I create." for I create Jerusalem to be a joy and its people to be a delight. The man begged life for his little boy, and Jesus says, return home, your son shall live. The man put his trust in the word Jesus spoke to him and started for home. He was on his way there when his servants met him with the news. It seems like this is what you ask of me. You have promised me a place in solitude, and you will do it. Last evening it came so clear that since you are accomplishing the much greater things of my inner transformation, you certainly won't fail me in this lesser item of the outer environment. Though I may have to go back home to the monastery with no other assurance but your word.
That is really so powerful. And really does indicate a genuine transformation that's going on in you. Because whereas earlier in the experience, that the prospect of having to go back to the monastery and not having any way to fulfill this, at least for a longer period of time, this call to eremitic life filled you with so much anxiety and so much dread and care and concern. And now you can very quietly say, I know you have promised this to me, Lord, and I know you will fulfill it, even if for a time I have to go home. I have to accept your word just like this official accepted the word of Jesus and returned home.
And his son lived, my dream, my promise,
lives.
Will also live. Now, we would like to invite you to take a little time to ponder on anything that may have struck a chord in you as you were listening to our sharing today. We ask you to just settle quietly and listen to what is in your own heart, what is speaking most strongly to you at this time. Let us be quiet and listen. We thank you for joining us this evening. And if you wish to share with us some of your responses to our presentations, you can reach us through our website, www.ravensbreadministries.com. All small letters, no spaces. And there is a contact page on that website. Or you can email us directly at pkfredette@frontier.com. We really appreciate the responses that we have received from a number of our viewers, and also the blog comments telling us of what this series has meant to you, our viewers. If you want to go to our blog, some of them have been particularly moving, and you would reach it by going to www.ravensbreadministries.com/blog.
As usual, we'd like to take a few moments together and close this presentation with a prayer, again by Ted Loader. And we invite you, as we pray quietly, you will see visually a photograph of that famous trestle bridge. Several years later, it has been repaired and railings have been put on, but it's the same trestle bridge that Karen described in her journal entries earlier in the program. Catch us in our anxious scurrying, Lord, and hold us in this Lenten season. Hold our feet to the fire of your grace, and make us attentive to our mortality, that we may begin to die now to those things that keep us from living with you and with our neighbors on this earth. To grudges and indifference, to certainties that smother possibilities, to our fascination with false securities, and to our addiction to sweatless dreams, to our arrogant insistence on how it has to be, to our corrosive fear of dying someday, which eats away the wonder of living this day, and the adventure of losing our lives in order to find them in you. Catch us in our aimless scurrying, Lord, and hold us in this Lenten season. Hold our hearts to the beat of your grace, and create in us a resting place, a kneeling place, a tiptoe place, where we can recover from the disease of our self-importance, that we may become vulnerable enough to dare intimacy with the familiar, to listen cup-eared for your summons, and to watch squint-eyed for your crooked finger. And somehow, during this season of sacrifice, enable us to sacrifice time and possessions and securities, to do something about what we see, something to turn the water of our words into the wine of will and risk, into the bread of blood and blisters, into the blessedness of deed, of a cross picked up, a Savior followed. Once again, for Karen and myself both, we'd like to say thank you for joining us. God bless you, and good night.
God be with you.